Hey everyone, today I'm going to talk to you about Langerhans cell histiocytosis. If you're someone whose brain cells start frying the moment you start studying Langerhans cell histiocytosis, this video is for you. If you're visiting my channel for the first time, my name is Dr. Namra Aziz, resident dermatology. I make a lot of educational content. If you haven't subscribed my channel, please click the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notifications. In this discussion, I'll talk about following things. What is histiocytosis? What is Langerhans cell histiocytosis? Why would someone get Langerhans cell histiocytosis? Who gets Langerhans cell histiocytosis? And what are the different clinical presentations of Langerhans cell histiocytosis? First of all, it's very important to understand what is histiocytosis. Histiocytosis is the proliferation of histiocytes. What are histiocytes? Histiocytes are the cells which have CD34 positive stem cells in the bone marrow as their parent cell. What does that exactly mean? In bone marrow, there are two types of the cells which give rise to all the cells which are circulating in our blood. These are myeloid progenitor cells and lymphoid progenitor cells. Today, we are not interested in lymphoid progenitor cells at all, so we are going to put a cross in them. Myeloid progenitor cells can give rise to neutrophils, macrophages, and dendritic cells. It is the neutrophil monocytes colony forming unit that gives rise to histiocytes. But now there should be no confusion when you read the word myeloid dendritic cells. Histiocytes which are present in the skin are Langerhans cells, macrophages monocytes, and dermal dendritic cells. Of all of them, it is believed that Langerhans cells do not arise from the myeloid dendritic cells, but from the fetal liver derived monocyte precursors that migrate to the epidermis before the birth. After birth, in a steady state, epidermal Langerhans cells give rise to other Langerhans cells. During inflammation, monocytes derived from the same neutrophil monocyte colony forming unit migrate to the tissues and form macrophages and other dendritic lines. Next important thing would be, what are the histiocytes which are important in the skin? These are Langerhans cells, macrophages, monocytes, dermal dendritic cells. It is important to know that number 1 and number 3 are dendrocytes, which means they have long dendrites for antigen presentation. Obviously, they have other functions as well, but antigen presentation is their main function. So understanding all of this, our brain would draw a simple conclusion that Langerhans cell histiocytosis is the proliferation of Langerhans cells. Well, no. Langerhans cell histiocytosis is proliferation of the cells which are similar to Langerhans cells, but there are certain differences as well. I'll mention these similarities and differences in a while. Now, why would somebody get Langerhans cell histiocytosis? For long, Langerhans cell histiocytosis was considered an immune dysregulation, but with latest research, this has been proven wrong. There is no immune dysregulation in Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Then why would somebody get Langerhans cell histiocytosis? Basically, because of a mutation which is called as BRAF V600E mutation, our bone marrow cells go crazy and start producing a clone of cell which is identical to Langerhans cells in a sense that they express the same markers like Langerhans cells. For example, CD1A, S100, CD207, which is also called as Langerine. This Langerine also forms tennis racket shaped intracellular granules called as Purbeck granules. They're different from Langerhans cell histiocytes because they express FASN, which is another marker, and all of them are BRAF V600E mutated, and hence they are called as pathological Langerhans cell histiocytes. There is some debate about this pathogenesis. Remember when I said that Langerhans cells come from the fetal liver monocytes and migrate to the epidermis before the birth? Some authors believe that it is these cells which go crazy and lead to the Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Now, who will get the disease? It affects children between the age of 0 to 3 years. Males are affected more than females. Adults can also be affected, but very rarely. This clonal proliferation and BRAF V600E mutation definitely makes us think that is Langerhans cell histiocytosis a neoplastic process? Well, the answer is yes. This means that it is a neoplasm, but not necessarily a malignancy. So now what will happen when these clone of cells will migrate and affect different body sites? patients can develop single system involvement or multi-system involvement. Single system involvement can further be classified as unifocal and multifocal, and multi-system disease can further be classified as high risk and low risk. It is important to understand here that this classification is very important in understanding the prognosis of the patient and deciding the treatment. So first, what are the two multisystem forms of the Langerhans cell histiocyte? The two multisystem clinical presentation of Langerhans cell histiocytosis can be acute or chronic. When patients develop acute diffuse form, it's called as Little Sioux disease. And when patients develop chronic progressive form, it's called as Hand-Schuller-Christian disease. If single organ is affected, then the patient can either develop eosinophilic granuloma or congenital self-healing reticulohistiocytosis, which is also called as the Hashimoto's-Pitzker disease. In Little-Sieve disease, patients develop 1 to 2 mm in size, pink to skin-colored macules, papules, pustules or vesicles in the scalp, flexure area of the neck, axilla and perineum. Healing, crusting and secondary empedocnization can occur. Ulcerative plaques have also been defined. The most characteristic of all these lesions are papulosquamous lesions with greasy scale affecting the scalp and resembling seborrheic dermatitis. Petechia and purpura can also develop because of thrombocytopenia. In Little Sieve disease, patients can also develop subcutaneous nodules. These clonal cells can also go and affect other organs. For example, liver, spleen, lymph node, lungs, and bones. Osteolytic lesions, that is the bone involvement, is most common in the cranium. Even hematopoietic stem cell system can be involved, causing anemia and thrombocytopenia. It is important to know that bony involvement is the most common clinical feature of Langerhans cell histiocytosis, followed by skin. The prognosis of this form is very poor. Now let's get to the second clinical form, which is a multisystem disease called as Hand-Schuller-Christian disease. It is a chronic progressive form and is basically a triad of three things. Diabetes insipidus, which occurs due to the infiltration of Langerhans cells in the posterior pituitary, bony lesions and exophthalmos. Wait, then why do we even study it in dermatology? Because skin involvement can occur in 30% of the patients. What are the skin manifestations of Hand-Schuller-Christian disease? Well, they are pretty much similar to Little-Sieve disease. One thing that is important to mention in Hand-Schuller-Christian disease is ulcerative nodules can develop in oral and genital areas with premature loss of the teeth, possibly secondary to gingival lesions. Now let's move to the single-system disease. Eosinophilic granuloma is a single system involvement of Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Commonest presentation of which is bone fractures and otitis media. Skin lesions are very rare in eosinophilic granuloma. Congenital self-healing reticulohistiocytosis is also single system involvement of Langerhans cell histiocytes, and it is limited to the skin, and as the name suggests, it is self-healing. It is present at birth or few days of life with widespread red to purplish brown papillonodules which have vascular appearance or resemble blueberry muffin. Solitary papules or nodules which are eroded or ulcerated can also develop. Like I said, it's self-healing. So how much time does it take to heal? Well, it can take from weeks to months. So it's very, very important to understand that even the patients diagnosed with the congenital self-healing reticulohistiocytosis should be longitudinally followed, because it can transform into multisystem disease. There is another term which is called as the skin-only Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Well, the only difference between the congenital self-healing reticulohistiocytosis and skin-only Langerhans cell histiocytosis is the time at which the disease presents. If it is present within the first 4 weeks of the birth, it is called as the congenital self-healing histiocytosis, and if it is present after 4 weeks, it is called as skin-only Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Like I said before, adults can also get Langerhans cell histiocytosis, but very rarely. Now what happens when adults get Langerhans cell histiocytosis? Most common involved sites are skin, lungs, and bones. The course is chronic and progressive. Skin manifestations are similar to childhood. Thank you so much for watching my video. If you have any questions, please comment below. In the next video, I'll discuss differential diagnosis, pathology, prognosis, and treatment of Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Do subscribe to my channel and give me a thumbs up if you like my video. Thank you so much. See you guys soon. Till then, bye-bye.